To when we all get to heaven, because that's what it's about. It's world famous. Brother Ray, he's going to come up and bring us the message, and I tried to give you as much. Calvin just wouldn't come up and sing, so I don't know. He always says 2 hours.
2 hours. I can't even do it. 2 hours sitting at home on my living room. I'll be okay, Mike. Well, I won't be okay, but. Well, there you go. Oh, what we got here? A microphone. Yeah, there
the
we
pulpit
go.
Mic's not picking it up.
Now, what do I do here now? Is it ready?
Is it?
It's ready.
Just clip it.
Can you hear me now? Okay. Brother Don said all I had to do was get up here and tell everybody how much I love the Lord. And I said, hey, I can do that. Because I do. But tonight, I guess we need to open up in prayer here. And thank God for us all being here. Thank God for this world that we have the privilege of living in. And, well, Father, Lord, we come here tonight in your house, Lord, and pray that you just be with us and with our families as we go through these trials and tribulations of this horrible disease that's among us. And Father, we just pray that you'd be with us throughout this season, Lord. We got the upcoming Christmas season. Let us always remember to lift our hearts and our joys to you, Lord, because we know you're the reason for that season, Lord. And as we should be every day of our lives, should be for you, Lord, and be about you, and let others see us and see that the light that shines in us comes from you. And Father, we just pray that you just help me through the night, Lord, and help me to whatever you have me do, Lord. I just pray that you just play it on my heart, Lord, and pray that they'll come to understand what you're trying to do through me. Father, now we say these things and ask these things in your Son's magnificent name, of Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Alrighty. I really drawed a blank. I looked at some scripture and I looked at some devotional books, but I just really, I don't do this kind of thing, as you well know, and I don't know what to do, how to do it. But, yeah, as far as the Lord in my life, it's just been unbelievable. And if anybody ever needed a crutch, this boy needed three. And he's been there for me and carried me through so many trials and tribulations that you just wouldn't believe. And I know I couldn't have got through it without a lot of help from friends also. I got a lot of dear friends that have helped me through life and in my working world. When I was working, my last employment was my best employment, and I worked for Mike Roper for the last 7 years of my career. And he's right, yes sir. Went to work for the man, and right off the bat, the man's working side by side with me. Now, here's the owner of the plant working beside me. I didn't know how to react or how to take it, you know? Because every place I ever worked, the people that own the places, they don't know how to tell you, you know? And about 2 days of Mike working, me and me talking to Mike, calling him Mr. Roper. And he just stops me and says, hey, Mr. Roper is my daddy. He said, I am just plain old Mike. And it didn't take me but just a short time to realize just what I had stepped into. I stepped into a Christian environment. I stepped into a world where a man not only cared about his employees, he cared for their families. And that was something I had never seen. And I worked for big plants and small plants. But never did I ever think that I'd be one that could get along with the people that owned the places. But Mike Shore turned my world around. He was just a blessing to me and still blessing me today. And but I thought I'd give you a little bit of that and let you know, you know. And I'm still very, very blessed to have him as a friend, I tell you. He's been a good thing in my life. But tonight I don't really know what to say here. We get to thinking about, you know, just what's going on in the world today and how it's
become what it is. And what is to come, Lord knows, we don't, none of us know, but we can only pray and ask God to see us through it. But I'm afraid we're in for a lot of troubled times. But we know we don't have to worry about it, you know. We don't. With this disease that's about us and the situation in Congress and how things are going, you know, just the cost of living, the price of buying things, we're looking at what we see in Revelations. We're fastly getting to that point, you know, where it says we'll starve to death in the land of plenty. You better believe it, because it's going to happen, you know. I hope we're done gone and with the Lord before that comes about. I was reading a book the other day that it was written by Brother David Jeremiah. And he had a piece in there about the Antichrist, you know. And to read it and see what, of course, hopefully we'll be with the Lord when he's here and doing the horrible things that he does. But it leads you to believe it, and this man's good. He knows, anybody that's ever heard him preaching and teaching, they know this man digs deep and finds the truth. And he talks about this man's almost irresistible to people. Everybody just flocks to him. And it's like they can't help it. And the whole time, he's talking against God and building himself to be God, you know. And you see so many people nowadays in time that we went through, you know, like the ones that thought they were God and what they'd done. And people listen to that stuff. And you got to wonder, you know, how can all these people poison themselves with the Jones case, you know, literally drink poison, you know, because that's not been in our environment. That's not been our beliefs, never over here. And David Crest, all them nearly come through, and just, it's hard to believe that people can think these people are Jesus, you know, because there's not but one Jesus. And if you ever know him, you'll never forget him. And there's no way to be tricked out of knowing that you know him, you know. But I found that just unreal. But even back in the Old Testament, you know, where God's leading the children out of Israel, time after time, they rebelled against God, you know. And this man created miracle after miracle, and gave them their every want and needs. And yet they still did not get to go into the promised land and had to roam for 40 years on earth because they would not do what God commanded. And you think, you know, we live in a world where we believe in faith. You know, we read the Bible. We feel the Holy Spirit. But these people actually witness a pillar of fire to lead them. They complain about the food. He let quail come in and just commit suicide so they'd have meat to eat. Time after time done these things, and they've seen it with their own eyes, yet they still could not believe, you know. And you think about that, and you think, that's just unreal that people can be that, go back in the, slide back in the same condition where they was. And most of it was agreed, if you remember, you know, because they always wanted stuff for themselves, you know. Couldn't wait to get to the new promised land, couldn't wait to have this, couldn't wait to have that. And they just better be thankful they had a graceful God to treat them as kind as he did. Because you stop and think, what if you was God and people were doing that to you, you know? We just don't know how lucky we are. We really don't. And I think about things like that a lot, about the Old Testament, the New Testament. Christ comes, he changes the law and changes the world, you know. So many times these things that come about and come up that we witness and see, a lot of it's our own fault because we do not step up to proper time and say, hey, this ain't right. America itself was founded on God, but yet we allowed to take prayer out of schools, let them dictate what our kids can and cannot do. And time after time, these things just come back, and it goes on. And you gotta wonder, you know, why didn't we step up? Why don't we do what we need to do to make, like your atheist, for instance. Here's a guy, he claims he don't believe in God. I wonder, is there really any true atheist? If a man stood right here and told me, hey, I don't believe in God, and I pulled out a 45 and cocked it and put it in his head, guess who will call on him? He'll start praying and call on God. And any time they're coming in court and they're trying to get things stopped like it, I look at it like this. If the only thing they haven't been taken off of is the money. If they don't believe in God, they ought to take all their money and give it back, because you can't have prayer. And it's right there in God We Trust. Is a segment of a prayer. Yeah. So are they atheists or are they not atheists? I can't buy it. They're just people who want to complain, like a lot of other things that goes on in this world. And it's funny that a small minority group can cause such a big wave in the ocean like that. But it happens every day. I think it's going to come a time when we're going to have to step up and say, no more. We can't allow this no more. But are we too late, you know? And in one sense, and then in another sense, I think this world, the way it's going, it probably ain't going to be around that much longer, and we're not going to have to worry about it. As Mike said when we was talking about this disease the other night, what's the worst can happen? You'll just get there to heaven before others do. And that's the truth of it right there. Yeah, that's the truth. My mom and dad has passed away. They're in heaven. And they had a long, drawn-out period that they went through with the disease that they had and passed from. But I know where they are, so I don't have to worry about it. Hallelujah. And a great, great thing was, my dad, the last year and a half of his life, he accepted Christ about a year and a half before he died. And my brother and I witnessed it. He was trying to tell us something that day, but he couldn't speak. His voice was all chopped up, and he couldn't make out what he was talking about. But every time I walked by the chair, he'd get my attention and start this again. And finally it dawned on me. I told my brother, I said, he wants to know what he needs to do to get saved. I said, I fully believe it. And I asked him, was that what he wanted? He nodded his head, yes. So we prayed with him and told him the Lord prayer that he needed to pray. And it made the difference. I mean, you knew it. And it was a day for us to remember. If anybody else has got anything they'd like to say or anything that tonight, would y'all got anything y'all would like to say?
I'm thankful that you finally got the nerve to do what you're doing. A year ago, 2 years ago, you wouldn't dare. And I'm just,
it's,
if the Lord's living in your life, or you wouldn't have been able to do it tonight.
Well, it's definitely out of my comfort zone, but, you know, it's, if the Lord can't take care of us, ain't nobody can. Because as I've said before, when I've tried to sing a couple of times, it's not me, it's the Lord moving in me, you know. And usually I would be scared to death and ask that I not have to do it. But I've come to the point that, you know, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm never going to learn what I'm doing if I don't let the Lord work with me and through, you know. So hopefully if I do it enough, maybe I'll get to where it's suitable, you know, to hear. But as I was saying goes, the Lord says, you know, it says in the Bible, you know, nothing he sends out it will turn back void. It's going to increase or grow or help someone somewhere. And a lot of things that we see in life, you know, that we scratch our head and say, why? why did this happen, you know. It's to benefit somebody or someone. I fully believe it. I always have believed that. We might not know it until we're passed on, but God does things for the good of men and people. And same goes with this country. It's going to turn around one of these days, but it'll probably be God who turns it around. And it's going to be a sad day for some folks that thought they had it all their way. I'd say that. I pity for them, and all you can do is pray for them. That's all you can do, you know. But I think a lot of people, you know, there's this and that about what's a good president, what makes a good president. I think Trump done an excellent job the 4 years he was in there. A lot of people don't agree with him. They got people they like, but that's human. We each got individual voices and individual minds to think with. But he sure turned around a lot of stuff that needed turned around. And I think he's the best one we've had since Reagan. Reagan done an extremely good job. But we had some pretty awful presidents in between there. And I don't know what this new guy's going to do, but it's plain to see, and anybody can tell you, it might be in the business, man, probably tell you the best, that there's no such thing as equality when it comes to money. Everybody can't make the same amount of money. It just don't work that way. And you can't sit at home because you'll make more at home than you would if you were, because it doesn't take long, that's going to bankrupt the country. It sure is, because somebody's got to do the labor. It's got to be done. And I pray the Lord gets that straightened out pretty fast before we get in so much worse a shape than we're already in. That's the main thing. We need to pray about it and pray to God that he does straighten a lot of this stuff out, you know. Because just imagine, we might not see too much that's happening now in our lifetime, because we're at that age now where we've not got too much longer to go. But I think about my 2-year-old and 4-year-old grandkids. And what their life's going to be like. But I know God's going to take care of them because I know their parents.
Amen.
My son tonight, he works the sound equipment and stuff for his church. That's where he's at. And my daughters are all in church except for Mandy. She had to work tonight, and y'all know where Mandy's at. But when we stop and think about what's yet to come, and we think about our young kids and what they're going to face in their lifetime, you're glad you're going to be with the Lord, and you won't have that worry and burden there, because he said we won't have to worry about nothing when we get to heaven. We'll be in no pain. We'll have brand new bodies. If worse comes to worse and they get took out, they're going to be coming to join you. That's the good part about it. But you just hope that they don't have to go through no torment or anybody harm them in any way while they're here on earth. Is there anything anybody, y'all got anything y'all would like to say? I was thinking back the other night that of the many, many blessings, I can tell you some blessings and miracles, you know. People talk about miracles, you know, you don't see miracles like you used to and stuff, but miracles happen every day. We may not recognize them as miracles, but my wife and I have witnessed several miracles in our lifetime that we knew was nothing but a miracle. We watched a 2.5-pound baby who is about that tall now, little. He's not completely, fully healthy, but he's living and he's not mental or nothing. He's just slow. He's slow. But he should have not ever lived. And he stayed in the hospital for a whole week after he was born, and they didn't give him much hope, but all the churches got together and prayed. And prayer is strong. Prayer works. I remember Mandy had seizures when she was 4 years old. She had seizures, had 9 seizures back to back. And they had to give her so much phenobarbital that she couldn't breathe on her own. So they had to put her on oxygen. She turned as blue as that cover on that pew there. And they run us out of the emergency room. Hit my knees and prayed. When 4 hours later, the prettiest thing I ever seen was her looking at me and saying, "Daddy, I love you." My son, he was about 4 years old when he found out he had leg Perthes disease. He only had 20% of the knuckle on his right hip. So they had to do hip surgery on him. But one of the treatments, and like I say, he's 4 years old. One of the treatments they have to do, they have to put him in cast. And what that cast consists of, he got a cast on both legs with bars across it that join the cast together. They spread their legs apart and push that joint back up in the hip socket. What it is where your little knuckle, your hip joint, goes up into that slot. His was only 20% of the size it was supposed to be. On x-rays, you can see it plain as day. But they spread his little legs at 4 years old, 35 inches apart. And when they brought him in there that night, he was screaming bloody murder. Begging me to cut them bars. And I was about ready to do it. But he had to do that for 6 weeks or 6 months, was it, buddy? 3 months, okay. But anyway, they took them off of him, and they had to put new ones on him, but they brought his legs in. But he went like 2 weeks for him to heal up a little bit before they did this. And we're sitting there in that hospital room thinking he's fitting to come down that hall like he did the first time. Scared to death. And again, when that happened to him the first time, I hit my knees and prayed. But he comes back and I'm praying now. You know, "Lord, don't let me go through this again, because I'll cut them bars for sure this time," you know. And here he comes down the hall. He's sitting up on that little buggy they push you around on, and he's playing, and they made him a little chicken balloon out of one of them surgical gloves. It didn't hurt him a bit, you know, and he was just tickled pink, you know. So that was a very, very big sign of relief when we seen that, you know. But he was a character. My friends used to kid him, said, "Son, so God made you legs and last your lifetime." He said, "Here you are, you done wore them out in 4 years." You know? But it's real common in real hyped kids that run and play and jump all the time, and he was that way. He'd jump off anything and everything. But that was another time that God seen us through a lot of troubled times. If we stop and look back and think about all the times that God's intervened in our life and helped us, and that's just in the bad times, the almost bad times and the good times, is it would probably literally blow you away to know how much good God does for us that we don't appreciate enough and don't talk about it to him and pray to him enough for what he does for us. And I'm quick-tempered and impatient for doing things. Anybody knows me can tell you that. I ain't got no patience for it, waiting on things, and things have happened to me to where I just absolutely get mad as a hornet. And God, I've tried my best to get God to help me with that, and he has. Believe me, he has. But that's one of the problems I was trying to, I slip back into. You know, if I don't watch myself, I am so quick to get angered. But compared to what I used to be, believe me, I'm an angel. Yeah, I don't think Mike's ever seen me mad but about twice since he's known me, but he has seen me in one of my awful states. I'm not a good person to be around him, I might. But I've seen him pretty heated up too in this life. And his son. But we all do that. We're human. We make mistakes every day of our lives. All day long we make some kind of mistakes. But thank God we've got God to take care of that and see us through it. And that's about all I got, folks. And I'll get someone to close us in prayer. Mike, would you like to close us in prayer tonight?
Father, we come to you thankful, Lord, for the change.